Hi, everybody. Welcome back to Paleontologists Rank, the Dinosaur Designs of Jurassic World Evolution 2. This week, we are looking at our second long-necked sauropod dinosaur, one of the most standard sauropod dinosaurs to ever evolve and be depicted, Camarasaurus. But before we look at it, we're going to introduce ourselves again. I'm Dr. James Napoli. I'm a postdoctoral researcher at the North Carolina State Museum and the North Carolina Museum of Natural University.
You got it in one.
My name is Amelia Zelo. I'm a PhD candidate at the Museum of Natural American in New York City.
I didn't mean to blow my nose over your take there. I thought James was going to redo it, so I thought I'd have a second.
Thank you.
We didn't hear it. No audio.
I didn't hear it.
Oh.
You're good.
Amelia, you can redo it, so I'm not.
No, it's
just
funny.
Doing that while I'm.
I don't.
He's stalling. He's trying to think of a funny thing to say.
Oh,
I got it.
All right, because his name is his title is so long and convoluted. It's going to be not as easy
to
mess up.
It's
going to
be absolute word salad.
Don't worry, I've already thought of something that'll be funnier.
Hi, my name is Scott Johnston. I am preparator in Vertebrate Museum Comparative Zoology, Harvard. I don't know. It is word salad.
Well, that's surprising because jokes do come in threes. Sorry, is that your official introduction, or do I go now?
Yeah, you can go now.
I'm Alex Rubenstahl. I'm a PhD candidate at Yale University, and I'm a strong believer in pointing out stolen valor. And James Napoli is stealing valor from people with medical degrees by calling himself a doctor. Stolen valor! Stolen valor!
Hi, and I'm Yale University, a PhD candidate at Dalton Meyer. And together,
we're the skeleton crew.
Not to be confused with the upcoming Disney Plus series.
Do you know what's fun, guys? We record many of these episodes in one night, and we're a little loopy by the last one we do. This is the last one for the evening. Dalton, let's get on with it so we can go to sleep. Let's see Camarasaurus.
Here they come.
Oh, shit, what up? I made that joke last episode. Never mind.
You did.
Well, make it one more time and it'll be great because they come in threes.
That's great. That's one of the best things that we produced.
I like how, like, right at the beginning of this series, we were like, oh man, Dalton has some funny, like, lines. We're going to latch onto those. I quite like that. And then it's immediately, no.
No, make fun of James. Listen, I've told Josh Hedge in my lab that the problem that he and I have in our relationship is we're both the designated joke friend. And we don't know how to interact, where we're like constantly trying to make the other one the designated joke friend. It's very funny as a dynamic because it's like this constant battle for dominance and who's going to be slightly bitchier to who.
Yeah.
It's little beta energy.
James arguing with people in his lab? That is unheard of.
Unheard of. Shocking.
Dalton, you have an uncanny ability of cutting away from animals as soon as they're going to do their social animation.
It's my special, interest.
James and I never argue. We're always...
I'll go back to this group of three. Maybe they'll
You're on the same frequency.
You know what else is in threes, Dalton?
Jokes.
Jokes. This is here. Comedy.
Camarasaurus. What can we say about this?
What does it mean?
It's the vaulted chambered lizard, in reference to the... Alex, you take this. I forget exactly what those things are called when they engorge into the vertebrae.
The pleuroceals?
Pleuroceals. Thank you. That was the word.
The diverticuli are the soft tissue that carve, that make the pleuroceal.
Gotcha. So...
I guess that's what they're named after.
Yes. So they are named after the pleuroceals, the areas of the vertebrae that the air sacs push into that make these kind of chambers that apparently are reminiscent of what you see in cathedrals, in churches. So they're these big vaulted chambers. For my entire life, thought it was because of the head. because they have big ol' Nereus. They have big ol' airheads. And it really looks like the top of their head, like everything above their maxilla is just like sticks. They're really weird looking animals.
Up until this instant, I thought that, Scott. I have learned that it's not named after the skull right now.
You're welcome.
See, here at the Skeleton Crew, we're learning all the time.
So
lifelong learning.
So one thing that I like about Camarasaurus, given that I'm a splitter and I like it when there's multiple things in one genus, is that there's three, maybe four species recognized. And what I love is that they really fit the pattern of the third neglected child. So the first species, the type species, is Camarasaurus supremus.
Awesome. The
huge, big species, huge, the supreme vaulted chambered lizard. Then there's Camarasaurus grandis. It's less big.
But
it's grand. It's grand. And the third species is Camarasaurus lentus.
Nap a lot.
Camarasaurus lentus, which lentus is Latin for slow. So they're like, we've got the supreme one, we've got the grand one, and we got the slow one.
Hey, Mama Joey's just a little slow, that's all. You don't mean it.
I'm now just picturing one of these as it just has the fucking Supreme logo on the side. It's bass boosted and crushed. Like, I wonder which one, which species this is in the game.
I don't think it's possible to tell.
No, because so one of my classmates at Carthage, his thesis project was trying to sort out Camarasaurus taxonomy. And it's like, it's a big mess. It's very hard because like they were named based on like, you know, the ye olde types of characters, which are not really that helpful or consistent. Like,
right.
I think like a lot, like I think one of the differences between, I believe, Supremus and Grandis is just that one of them is bigger than the other. And it's like, cool.
Yeah. Well, nice. Right. I mean, Emmanuel Schopp has talked about the same thing. I've seen him talk about it just in like Facebook comments where people are like, hey, are you going to figure out Camarasaurus taxonomy? And he's like, I don't know. Yeah. Like, it's hard.
Yeah, it is specifically stated that except for its huge size, it was indistinguishable from Lentus.
Yeah,
that's very funny. But wait, Lentus gets sunk then, which means we might lose. Is that Supremus versus Lentus?
That's Supremus versus Lentus.
Well, then so Lentus we lose Supremus. Lentus. Right, right. Thank God we keep Camarasaurus Supremus.
But, so,
Man, I sure hope these persistent taxonomic issues aren't influencing assumptions made in the modern field of dinosaur paleontology.
Oh, so, of course they're not. Surely we've inherited no baggage that needs to be sorted out.
Okay, it's not entirely just vibes. So it isn't just that one big. It's also that Supremus is known from the uppermost parts of the Morrison exclusively, and Lentus and Grandis are from the lower.
Oh, good. So it's also stratigraphy.
It's
great.
Also
wait, but if there are no morphological distinction, how do they know?
Because it's
everything big. But the one thing that matters.
So, yeah.
That doesn't solve any problems.
Well, here's how we know, Alex. I've only found things that I'm calling Camarasaurus lentus low. And the reason I know that is that if I find them low, I only call them Camarasaurus lentus.
I should work on
Florent.
Circular logic. Never heard of her.
It's a scientific Ouroboros.
Marsh is supposed to be the based one. Why is he doing this to me?
I mean, Cope was the based one in terms of modern animal taxonomy. It's amazing to me how bad Cope was at paleontology because he names like most of North American reptile and fish species. And like, that's pretty much shaken out.
Oh, wow. He figured out extant things.
Well, I mean, what I'm saying is he was a good biologist who like mostly got what we've now confirmed with DNA. And then with paleontology, okay, he just couldn't do it.
Because he was stupid and racist.
Well, right.
Well, more racist.
He was racist.
More racist.
Racister.
On a racist and stupid axis, he was not plotting above the line. So the species of Camarasaurus might change in the future, it sounds like. We'll have to keep at least Supremus, but it's possible Lentus won't exist.
Well, we'll probably talk about this when we eventually get to the animals in prehistoric kingdom, right?
Right.
I think they have the different species.
They have all three. Yeah.
Well, there's also a fourth species, maybe. It's Camarasaurus lewisi, sometimes argued to be a member of a different genus. I know from what Wikipedia says, Emmanuel Schaap has actually flip-flopped on it. He's like, he's just not sure what to do with it.
Hey, is there any meaningful distinction between a genus and...
We'll talk about Vibes. That in a separate video. Vibes. we're unsure how different they really are. So there might be four species of Camarasaurus. This underscores the fact that Camarasaurus is pretty well represented in the fossil record.
Stupidly.
Yeah.
There's like over 500 specimens of this. This thing was everywhere.
It's the Triceratops of the Morrison.
Pretty much, actually. Like, it's one of the things that is notable about when I dug in the Cleveland Lloyd Dinosaur Quarry, I remember having some fireside chats with the PI, Dr. Joseph Peterson, about how that one of the things that's unique about that locality is that they don't find that many Camarasaurus there. It's just Allosaurus, but like 80% of what they find there is Allosaurus. It's f-ing weird.
So are sauropods like video game achievements where it's like you need 500 dead ones before you get a skull? It's 500 Camarasaur kills to unlock Camarasaurus skull, and we haven't hit that threshold for the other sauropods yet.
A little bit. Yeah, so sauropods, for the uninitiated, their skulls, when they died, popped off their necks like a champagne cork and landed somewhere about 20 miles away.
Filled with delicious goo, and the theropods ate.
It was actually really... So my first field experience was with Paul Sereno working at the old Howe Quarry, or part of it. And this is something we will talk about.
When was this?
When I was in high school.
Oh, f***, I didn't know that.
Cool. Yeah. I don't talk about it a lot. But it was my first time in the field. So it wasn't really... It's not the literal Howe Quarry, but it's one of those things in the adjacent area. I was working, and we'll talk about this more in another video, I know, because I was working in the Big Al Quarry.
Oh.
Which is actually something relevant to this a little bit. So the Big Al Quarry was discovered by Hans Sieber, who's a Swiss fossil collector. He's a commercial fossil collector. Very, very good at what he does, and has a museum that he's established in Switzerland for his own finds. So I think it's like what he decides not to sell goes there. I don't know, like, to what degree he sells versus reposits his discoveries, but, like, it's a pretty legit museum. And he's a very, very professional commercial collector, right? Because commercial collectors vary a lot in professionalism. He's really, really good. Anyway, he was working in the Morrison around Shell, Wyoming. Shell is a tiny, tiny town. When I first went there, it had 50 people in it.
God. Like,
50 people in three bars, and Dirty Annie's, which is a wonderful place that went away and I think has been resurrected by new owners. This is all inside baseball.
Praise be.
Yeah, praise be to Dirty Annie. So he was relocated. So the Howe Quarry was this old quarry that had been worked by Barnum Brown for the AM&H. We talked about that in the Diplodocus video. So what Sieber was doing was trying to find new productive localities in the same general area. And he found, at the top of a hill, just a whole Allosaurus skeleton that he just kept digging, and he just found vertebra after vertebra after vertebra after vertebra. And so he started excavating it. And then, apparently, a U.S. Bureau of Land Management agent was on a plane overseeing the land that he was responsible for surveying, and realized that Hans Sieber had accidentally strayed off of the private land he had agreements to work on and onto BLM land, where there was like a weird border.
Are you shitting me?
I'm not shitting you. So they realized that he was digging up this Allosaurus on U.S. government-owned land. And so he was immediately removed from the site. They contracted the Museum of the Rockies with Jack Horner to finish excavating the specimen, this is now maybe the most famous individual Allosaurus, Big Al. After that point, Jack Horner just, I think, declined the opportunity to keep working the site, and Paul Sereno approached the BLM and asked if he could kind of use it. It's a very productive locality. There was a lot more stuff under Big Al, so they've just kind of been excavating down into this hill. And Paul Sereno said, can I use this as a training site? So Paul Sereno teaches a class in dinosaur biology in Chicago at the end of every spring semester. He takes the students out for 2 weeks and they dig in the quarry. So it's like a really good place to learn field skills and everything. And then he would also do, as part of Project Exploration, which was a nonprofit he and his ex-wife founded, he would run like volunteer digs there. So he'd just stick around and then the undergrads would ship out. And that's how I went in. I went with my dad. And we went for 2 summers. So the first summer, we were mostly working on the pelvis of a new Camarasaurus individual. The pelvic block weighed, I want to say, about 10,000 pounds. It was one of the largest pieces of rock I have ever seen.
Yeah, that sounds about right.
Yeah. I remember just being under it a lot. It just, like, we were trying to pedestal it and we were chipping away at it. And there was the point, there was just the point where I noticed really, like, Paul Sereno just pulled all the young kids out of there and he was like, I'll finish the rest, when it was like the pedestals were just getting a little bit too narrow to be safe.
Mm-hmm.
What I remember Paul talking about a lot at the moment, or at the time, was that he was really, really hopeful that there would be skull material found with the skeleton, because there was a pelvis and there was like an articulated series of dorsals. And he was like, just like, there's never a head. It's very rare, like, it's probably not going to happen. But it would be cool. I went back the next summer, and the first thing Paul showed me is he's like, I fucking found it. And it was just under, like, an area where we had just been walking all the time. Like, it was just under a little bit of rock. And the whole skull was present, but had been, like, exploded outward. So it looked like it had been compressed. So the skull's all there. I have no idea what happened to the specimen. I assume it's in Paul's lab, but I've never heard anything about it. Right, but...
Dalton.
Yes.
Is a skull of Camarasaurus visible in Dinosaur National Monument?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. On the wall? Okay, just sorry, that just kind of crossed my brain.
And there's one at the AM&H, too, which is, it's isolated. It's in that glass box in that hall. It just... So... I guess to ask a bit about why we think we don't find skulls, even though we have lots of really decent postcranial material, is it, like, we joke about it being a champagne cork, which of course is not actually the case, but, like, do we think it's maybe because their skulls are so delicately built relative to the rest of the animal? Yeah, okay.
Yeah. I mean, it's also, like, it's the end of a long thing, and, like, almost no dinosaur tails are complete.
Right, because, like, that's the first thing to go... Yeah, that's the first thing to go when, like, scavengers show up. They tug, you know, on the limbs and on the tails and on the necks and
pull out the eyes easier. And
the eyes and the tongue and all these other things that are soft and easy to pick at.
Yeah, and the brain was like probably a little delicious pickle.
Yeah, and like so yeah, and that was something that always kind of strikes me about the Camarasaurus skull at the AM&H is how delicate it is. Like, it's just, it's so delicate that it's weird. It looks like an alien. Like, I don't really 100%. Now, this is like a bit of an exaggeration, but I feel like I don't understand it. Like, when I look at it, it's not like when I look at a T-Rex skull. It's like, yes, I know where the nose goes. I know where the eye goes. There's teeth in there and it makes sense. I look at the Camarasaurus at the AM&H and I'm like, that's an alien drawn by a child.
Yeah.
Like, it is so weird looking.
Yeah.
You're correct to feel that way.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you for validating my horror. Yeah.
I don't know that there has ever been an animal on Earth that to humans would have been as, like, unknowable as a sauropod dinosaur.
Mm-hmm.
Just, like, everything, like, aside from their quadruped body, they're just so different from anything that exists.
This is something that I know Romer talked about. It's quoted in a plaque about turtles at the AM&H, is that, like, if turtles were not extant, we would not believe them if we started finding them in the fossil record. Like, it's so weird.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we think about them as, like, you can just buy one at the dime store. because I'm apparently 85 and remember when the time stores
were going down to the dime store by a dime store turtle.
You can go down to the soda fountain and hit up the dime store and get yourself a pet turtle.
Get yourself a penny candy and a radio slider.
I mean, you could just go to the turtle pond in Central Park and grab one.
They're just free
outside turtles.
So what I'm saying is
the government can't stop them.
So there are turtles now, and we can look at them, and we can have them as pets, and we don't think of them as weird. And I think to some degree, sauropods are so entrenched in popular culture as like archetypal dinosaurs that we fail to realize that these are incredibly fucking bizarre.
Yeah,
like
I agree.
This would have been one of the most, like, I don't want to say even upsetting. Like, this would have just been a shocking thing to see in real life.
Oh my god, yes.
Yeah.
And their skulls are weird. Their skulls are really weird.
Yeah.
It's. I don't want to get stunlocked about palates, but.
Yeah.
The skull is basically all cranial sinus, and like the nares are like rotated up, and then the choani is vaulted up and like pushed back. It's like someone just went zoop. It's more like zoop. Like, it's not just short, it's
bolted. Like, if you look at the skulls of like brachycephalic dogs, when you're just like, this is wrong, and like this is screwed up in a way that's like viscerally upsetting. Like when you look at the skull of like a pug or a French bulldog.
Yeah.
And like, yeah, to kind of, sorry.
No, go ahead.
Just to kind of finish the turtle point, like when I first took a comparative anatomy class in, as an undergrad, where I was still like not as familiar with the skeleton as I am now. So a lot of bones were just surprising to me. And I remember like first like understanding a turtle skeleton and like realizing how messed up they are. Like, it's kind of a different... It's a different perspective. I'm trying to think, like, with sauropods, like, most people know them from popular media. And even just, I'm thinking dinosaurs in general. People are so familiar with Triceratops, Stegosaurus, Brachiosaurus, T-Rex. And most people don't have, like, this kind of, like, everyday relationship with the skeleton like we do working on fossils. And so, like, the weirdness of these animals is really in the bones, and that's something that just escapes most people. Because they don't. Most people are not working on these things every day, or working on living animals. And there's like no, I guess, I don't know. It adds to the weirdness. Like again, like for me, like turtles threw me through a loop when I learned that they put their arms inside of their rib cage. I'm like, that's disgusting and wrong. And why would you do that? And sauropods are the same way. It's like the more you look at them, the weirder they get, the more cursed they get. Like they're not. And on a scale of, like, cursed animal skeletons, I wouldn't put them at the top of the list as most cursed, but they're up there. They're in the running.
Right. They're not standard, is I guess what I'm saying.
Mm-hmm.
No.
Yeah. Well, they're not turtles, but they're weird.
They're built different.
Yeah.
True are.
I think pterosaurs also easily fall into that.
Yeah.
But it's just easy for us to turn them into a bird bat in our brain versus a sauropod where it's like, I don't know what to do with this shape.
They're alien.
They are. They're not like their size compounds that, right? Because like, even like most humans' daily lives don't even encounter like elephants, but these are orders of magnitude larger than the biggest things we would encounter today.
Right.
And Camarasaurus is on the relatively lower end of that. That like by no means is Camarasaurus either a small dinosaur or a small sauropod, but again, when we got visitors at the Cleveland Lloyd, because it is a site that you can actually visit if you want to drive many hours through the desert. There are a couple little metal shacks over the over the fossil site. It's an active fossil site that they go to in the summers. And fun fact: corrugated metal shacks in the sun, very hot in those. But people every once in a while came to visit them. And Surprise, surprise. I talked at people about dinosaurs when they asked questions.
Oh my God.
Man, maybe I should help make a YouTube channel about that or something. Get an outlet for this. That'll surely keep me from doing it in my everyday life. But so one of the fun phrases that you get to say as a paleontologist is these guys were asking about the Camarasaurus, and I got to say that, oh, this is Camarasaurus. It's about a mid-sized sauropod. It was only about 40 feet long.
Right.
That is an insane sentence.
Right. Yeah. We just don't... Sauropods are just bafflingly large. One interesting thing about the skull-like build is that I think it's been really interesting in trying to figure out how sauropods worked physiologically. Their heads are not made for chewing, which they're reptiles, so you would expect that. But ornithischian dinosaurs generally tend to evolve to chew pretty well. Sauropods don't, and their skulls are lightly built. They're not doing a lot of oral processing of the food. Like, it's led to this model where we kind of just imagine them almost vacuuming up fern material and pine needles, just using the head as a means to get it into the body. Yeah. Which means like, that they must have had...
I was just gonna say, if you've ever grabbed onto like a pine tree and you just grab a branch and kind of run your hand along it and like pop the needles off, it's like that at scale.
Right. Whenever I'm stripping rosemary off of a stem, I'm always thinking of that scene in Walking with Dinosaurs with the baby Diplodocus where they're just...
Right. And it's just that, but industrialized.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Like, these things must have had enormous fermentation chambers in their guts as well. They were probably hindgut fermenters like horses and rhinos, because I doubt they evolved a complex foregut fermentation system like ruminants. It also would be insane. Like, they wouldn't ruminate. They can't chew. So they would have had to be fermenting it in the hindgut.
Yeah.
Which, this is important. Like, you might not realize this because being an herbivore seems like the default, but the default for vertebrates is to eat other vertebrates. Or at least other animals. Eating plants is hard because plants are tough to digest. So when you're a plant eater, you have to ferment the plant material somehow. There's a reason you can't eat grass.
Right.
and so if you can touch it, and you should, but you should not eat it. So sauropods are going to be fermenting all of this plant material somewhere to break down cellulose so that they can digest it. And I guess what I'm saying is they must have smelled awful.
Yeah.
And we also, to that end, we find on occasion piles of polished stones in the gut contents of sauropods. I don't know that that's been found in Camarasaurus per se, but I believe it's been found at least in Supersaurus, that we infer to be gastroliths, so-called stomach stones, really more like gizzard stones, like what you see in chickens when they eat pebbles. And they're not just doing it because they're stupid, although they are stupid. There's no love lost between me and chickens. But
I feel like there's a story there, Dalton.
I've never had a pleasant interaction with a chicken. I'm sure there are nice ones. People seem to like them, but I've not met the nice chickens. But it seems that these animals were swallowing small stones that would sit in a chamber of their digestive system to help them grind up plant material, because they're not chewing their food. They don't have molars. They don't have even any kind of equivalent to molars. They are simply swallowing it all. And there's some mechanical processing going on, but it's not being done by teeth. It's being done by rocks that they eat.
Right.
Well, and maybe not. There is a paper from 2007 that is specifically no gastric mill in sauropods, new evidence from an analysis of gastroliths mass and function in ostriches. And it is specifically refuting that gastroliths were used to break up plant material.
Then what were they there for?
Maybe they were a display structure. No.
No.
I don't know. Let me actually like read through this a little bit and then I'll get back to you. What I've been able to discern from this is, so these guys did an experiment with ostriches and seeing how their gastric mill works. And one of the things that they observed in this is that the avian-style gastric mill stones are not in the body long enough to develop a polish. Is one of the things. Feeding experiments with farm ostriches show that bird gastroliths experience fast abrasion in the gizzards and do not develop a polish. And also, the sauropods that we find gastroliths with, or I guess air quotes gastroliths with, are incredibly... We're finding way less of them than we would expect to, or at least way less of them than we find in birds. The gastrolith mass is less than 0.01% of the body weight, and which is an order of magnitude less than what we see in ostriches and other herbivorous birds, and it's also less than we see fossilized in other dinosaurs that have gastroliths, which other dinosaurs that have gastroliths are relatively on par with what we see in birds.
What are those other dinosaurs, do they say?
There's some ornithomimosaur. Sorry, not ornithomimosaurs. Oviraptors? Yeah.
I see caudipters. I take umbrage
a little bit. They're ornithischians, too.
The lack of mass to me seems easily explainable by taphonomy.
They do say that in the paper. They're this could be that.
And the polishing, I wonder if it's a size effect, that they're just eating bigger rocks.
Yeah,
because they're bigger animals, and they have more powerful gastric mills.
I think they're pretty polished in caudipteryx. I think Cetacosaurus, right?
Cetacosaurus, they're not... So the specimen that I described early in my PhD had a couple of associated gastroliths. They're not, polished, like rock polished. They're not completely crude. They're clearly worn down, but I wouldn't say they're polished. You can see a picture of them in the Open Access publication. But I think that the critical thing here is, there's kind of two things. They explicitly say throughout the paper, based on my skimming of it, that they're refuting an avian-style gastric mill.
Yeah.
It doesn't rule out the possibility that these were using gastroliths in a, sauropod-style gastric mill that is different somehow. I think the fundamental point is, a gastric mill is not ancestral to saurischia.
What if they were weird, though?
They propose that maybe they were ingesting rocks for mineral supplementation, and that's why they look different and they're kind of behaving differently. I wouldn't be surprised if it was also a gastric mill and it was just an independent innovation and maybe there was a much longer residence time. I don't know.
Yeah. I think Dalton's probably...
I have many issues with the suppositions that is made there. But, I mean, maybe. I don't know. It's all unknowable, so...
Yeah. Now that we've talked about...
We are faced with the problem that these things don't fucking chew.
Right. They're certainly not chewing. And there has to be mechanical breakdown. And Alex was saying earlier, I don't know if we're cutting this part of the video or not, so I'll hedge my bets. There was a conversation earlier that may or may not be in the video where Alex mentioned that the gizzard has fairly limited chemical breakdown. Right? So this is a thing in alligators as well as birds. There's a proventriculus, which is the chemical breakdown site, but then you pass into the muscular gizzard. So you actually secrete the acid first, then everything winds up in the gizzard and you mash it all together. And that's the breakdown that's allowing chemical digestion to continue.
You think that'd be hot?
It might be.
Like in vor fetish, is that the best part? Sorry.
Tell us if it's hot. It's an interesting question how these digested their food. I think the only answer that I am interested in is how bad were their farts? And I think constant, omnipresent, and suffocating. I think the air at ass level and down from these animals must have just been methane.
Oh my god, I figured out why we don't find small animals in the Morrison.
They were all choked to death.
The sauropod farts just cleared the whole area.
Gas.
Career-ending nature paper right there.
I also do want to mention that specifically the Camarasaurus in this game, when they eat, they do chew. It's a little bit, but they do chew.
Yeah, I think most of the sauropods do.
They do, but we're talking about now. Hey, perfect timing.
All right, what kind of sauropod is Camarasaurus?
It's a big nose.
Macronarian.
Macronarian. in our Diplodocus video, we said, we talked about a little bit, but we talked about kind of the general trends of the sauropod tree, which I will reiterate very quickly. At the bottom, there are a bunch of things that are in the kind of this informal paraphyletic group called prosauropods. They're not one big group, but they're these early diverging members of the clade, and they're bipeds, and they get bigger and leggier as you go up. And then there are all these things that are proper sauropods, but not neosauropods. And then the two really big groups, by the time you're hitting the late Jurassic, are the neosauropods, which we can characterize as follows. There are the whip-tailed ones, or the quote-unquote whip-tailed ones, the flagelli caudatans, and they are long.
Longus.
And then there are the macronarians, like Camarasaurus and Brachiosaurus and the later Titanosaurus. And they are tall and thunk, and also eventually very long. But they're the chunkier model. Although that is there are obviously exceptions to this rule. And they're characterized by a few features. And we can see most of these features in Camarasaurus, one of which is they have these big fat nostrils on top of their head. And while kind of this dorsal and posterior migration of the nares is also something we see in the long-necked, long-tailed diplodocoids, those flagellate caudatans, and in macronarians, they are very big, and they're kind of sitting up on the head. Additionally, they also have different teeth, where diplodocids have these awful pegs that we showed you in the Diplodocus video. Macronarians have these kind of almost spoon-shaped.
Shoveled,
spoon-shaped teeth. And much like diplodocids, they're all restricted to the front of the mouth, like this.
It's awful.
Not on Camarasaurus. They're not all not restricted to the front of the mouth like they are in Diplodocus. They go pretty far around. They do a normal thing on Camarasaurus.
Is this something that happens later in the group?
I think so.
It might be.
Hold on. I got to fact check myself.
But Dalton, can we zoom in and see if we can see if they got this thing's teeth right, even though I see it in the corner and they didn't.
Let me give it a shot. It's going to my favorite mode, the horrible camera.
And this will be easy to do with Camarasaurus because one of my least favorite things about this model is they cannot close their mouths.
I mean, the model looks terrible.
It's not my favorite.
Oh,
they kind of get it a little bit. Like,
Dalton, move the camera over just a little bit. You're blocking off with it. Yeah.
Oh, hang on. Behind the UI.
They're not that bad.
Not awful.
They're spoon shape.
They're a little small.
Yeah.
They're not bad.
They're not bad.
Honestly, this, I'm looking at this head and it's not as awful as I remember it being. There's some weird texture about the neck that I don't like that makes it looks like it has a dick vein.
Like a Snickers.
Yes. Also, I would like to react to the last thing I said about macronarians having teeth limited to the front of their mouth. That is something I made up. That's a thing for diplodocoids. I just looked up a bunch of titanosaurs. It's a fabrication. We made it up. I made it up. They have teeth. They have normal teeth.
And yeah, it is also absolutely worth noting that the little like snarl lip that they have in this version, where it makes it so they cannot close their mouths, is not what we see in Camarasaurus. They have pretty normal looking mouths, and
these feet aren't the worst things. Like the first digit is.
Do you
see
the back?
They have an enlarged manual digit on their hand, which is kind of.
They've got the thumb claw, but beyond that, I think they're pretty bad.
I think the thumb claw is a little small as well.
Also, this animation of this guy taking a little drink has prompted my brain. How did these animals suck water down their enormous throats with these stupid heads?
Good question.
It's not sauropods are too big to walk. It's sauropods are too big to drink.
So I remember I remember there was a little bit of a discussion after Prehistoric Planet came out, where, you know, the one scene in the Deserts episode where it has all of the different dinosaurs at the watering hole?
They haven't watched it, Scott.
I don't pay for Apple TV. I've seen only the first episode.
Okay, clips. So in this hypothetical world where people have seen this, I'm now changing the you from Dalton and Alex to you, the viewer, the audience.
The viewer who's definitely seen Prehistoric Planet.
If you're watching our stuff, you've watched Prehistoric Planet.
Or you don't have Apple TV.
Or you've pirated it. Yar. Yar. But so they actually, in that scene, they have a bunch of these different dinosaurs. Oh, James is doing an Alex thing and just leaving.
Sometimes nature calls.
So they have a bunch of these different dinosaurs drinking at this watering hole. They have hadrosaurs, they have a therizinosaur, they have Mononychus, all these different things, and they have a couple titanosaurs as well. And on a Twitter thread, it was specifically mentioned that they chose different drinking styles for the different animals that they think would be most plausible. And the way that they have the titanosaurs drink is essentially kind of, if you guys have watched how snakes do it, they kind of just like shove their face into it and then just like... just suck it up like that.
Yeah, that seems reasonable.
That does.
I mean, like, how else are they doing it?
Yep.
So here's the thing I wanted to bring up about this model that I really hate is the way that, like,
oh yeah,
the,
I don't like that
arm,
too.
Arm like out away from the body.
The neck's too thin.
Its shoulder girdle is like pushed off of its chest a bit.
This model looks kind of like clay sculpted versions of Camarasaurus that I made when I was young.
What the f*** is that shoulder doing?
The shoulders are upsetting. Well, and I mean, we're gonna not look at that anymore.
We could probably talk about shoulder mobility in dinosaurs in general, because like a lot of things animate the shoulder girdle as moving independently the way mammals do. Mm-hmm. And dinosaurs wouldn't have done that. Right, because in mammals, like, a specialty of mammals is that we've decoupled our shoulder girdles and made movable mm-hmm. joints, so we can move our scapulae independently, this, like, way that horses and antelope move, where you see the shoulder blade moving forward.
In or dinosaurs, like, if you watch big cats stalk, and they kind of, like...
Right.
You see them go up on the... Yeah.
So that's a mammal specialty. Reptiles, in general, have a fairly fixed shoulder girdle. There is some motion that occurs. I remember some interesting stuff that I don't know if it was ever published, but interesting stuff at like SICB and SVP almost 10 years ago now, showing like sliding motion at the coracosternal joint in crocodilians and lizards. So like there is mobility. I'm sorry?
How could you have possibly seen that at SVP 10 years ago?
Well, not fully 10 years ago, but it was in Berlin, 2014, which was my first one. 9 years ago.
Okay.
In any case, I don't know if that stuff was ever published, but like the idea that it's completely immobile is oversimplified. But in any case, you're not going to get this whole like shoulder blade swinging forward thing, because mm-hmm. the shoulder blade is articulating with a coracoid that's meeting the other coracoid. And like there's not a synovial joint between them. There
like
might
a whole
be
belt.
Some sliding. Right. They got a nice belt, and they've got a furcula maybe bracing it. Do sauropods have clavicles? I assume they do.
They probably have clavicles, yeah.
Not a furcula.
Good.
Monotremes don't have the mammal condition yet. They're like totally locked up. They actually have less modified the condition than reptiles.
Right.
So are they just a weird one out? Like, what is like? I'm thinking like therapsids and Dimetrodon and that kind of stuff. Like, what are they doing?
I don't know.
It's all locked up in Dimetrodon.
Okay.
I think it probably just hasn't evolved yet by monotremes. So it's like a Therian thing. Probably.
But
well, I don't know. Let me look at a cynodont real quick.
Yeah, no, look at one of those things that we know a lot about.
Sauropods definitely have clavicles.
They do. Okay. I assumed they would have, but I wasn't actually sure.
They do.
Yeah, I think cynodonts are not doing a lot of motion there.
Okay.
Although
that's interesting.
I got it. Like, listen, I'm not an expert on these animals. I am prepared to be told I'm wrong with it, but it doesn't look like they've completely freed up the shoulder girdle from what I'm seeing.
Even like Gorgonopsids too?
Oh, yeah. No, I don't think so.
Yeah, like, okay. I know nothing about them, and that's why I've never really thought about it before, but it does make sense.
Yeah, like, it's just, it's such a weirdly advanced thing for, like, fast locomotion. Or not fast, but, like, extreme mobility. This kind of gets into what we were talking about a few episodes ago. Like, mammals in general are characterized by some extreme mobility of their joints, mm-hmm. which is likely related to an ancestral theory and lifestyle that was what we call scansorial, which is kind of living like a squirrel, living between the ground and the trees kind of alternately and interchangeably. And that sort of very, very flexible generalized locomotion is what defines mammals at the base of the clade. So that's what we're inheriting. And a lot of our specializations are these really intricate hypermobility things, developing a lumbar region in the spine to allow twisting, separating the shoulder girdles so that your arms can move independently of each other. A lot of motion in the ankle that other animals can't do. We have all of these degrees of freedoms in our joint or in our joints that other groups of animals don't necessarily have.
So you're telling me this Camarasaurus couldn't climb a tree?
I don't think it could.
That's sad.
It is the tree.
If the tree was fallen and it was walking along it, one could construe that as climbing the tree if they were wrong.
The more I look at that shoulder girdle, the sadder I get, because like Camarasaurus is one of my favorite sauropods. I've always found it to be, like, even though it's kind of goofy looking with its short little like dopey pug face, I've always found it to be a kind of graceful, beautiful animal. And I always try to focus around like putting some Camarasaurus whenever I make in my park whenever I make one, and I think it's Stockholm syndrome at this point that I just want to like it a lot.
Yeah, this is not it. The prehistoric kingdom designs for Camarasaurus are gorgeous and have a lot of elegance to them, even though it's got a dopey pug face. Like, this is not great. The front end of the animal looks like it is a turkey that you've got your hand inside just because you're pulling out its gut cavity, right? Like, that's what I'm seeing.
Oh, it does!
Here. Yeah.
A positive, I will say. Oh, sorry, go on.
It's please. Just not great. That's it. It's not the best design.
Yeah. A positive, I will say, I've been really enjoying the noises they make.
Yeah.
I really like these low bellows and rumbles and stuff. I think that they sound amazing for sauropods.
I like the sounds. I also really like the patterns on the Camarasaurus in this. I think it's one of the more nicely patterned sauropods in the game.
Yeah, it is.
Although I could also be misremembering, because frankly, I never make too many sauropods in this game. I don't know why.
I looked through all the colors and patterns of a bunch of them recently, and this is one of the only good ones.
Yeah. I don't make a lot of sauropods in this game because they take up too much space, and you need so many trees for them that you can't see the sauropods.
Yeah, that's... They're just,
and don't they hate everything, too?
They hate each other.
Right, you can't just make one huge exhibit and have it be the sauropod house. Which is what I would otherwise do.
So you can.
Well, you can, because you turn that shit off. But
in true macronarian solidarity, Camarasaurus and Brachiosaurus are okay with each other.
Mm. That's good. They got big noses. They got to stick together. It's like Jews and Italians.
God fucking damn it!
All right, we're gonna jump away from that.
It's doing the mammal thing when it sits.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was about to say, like, those hips would be broken,
and its wrist would be broken.
Oh
and
God!
Its spine.
The arm looks broken. The angle of its neck coming out of the shoulder.
Like, look at that. That thing is broken on every level.
This is a dead animal.
Every night when I go to sleep,
I break all my bones
and my heart attacks put me to sleep.
this is rough. I don't actually want to... It kind of...
Okay, I can feel... A mania, like an insane mania, the onset of like a fatigue mania. So let's rank it.
Yeah.
I don't think we have anything else to say about Camarasaurus.
Not really.
No.
Let's take it to the viewer.
Yeah.
It's a sauropod. I try to like them, and they're aliens, and they make it difficult. This one, I was happy with it for most of this video, and then we saw it laying down and breaking its hips and wrists, and I really, really did not jive with it. Which is a shame, because, like, it's... it looks like a Camarasaurus from a distance, which I appreciate. Like, when I can tell what these things are, like, I've mentioned this before, I think, with Diplodocus, too. It's, like, it's not offensive from a distance. Like, I know exactly what this is. But then, like, just the details of the shoulders are wrong, the legs are broken when it lays down. Ugh. I don't know. I'll give it a C. Because, like, I don't hate it, but I really don't think that the details that I do appreciate, like the patterns and the teeth being mostly correct, do not make up for its broken wrists.
So, I mean no disrespect to the artist who made this model, who I do hope enjoys our videos, and who I do hope made models that we do like. I don't like this model at all. I think it is the ugliest sauropod in the game, by a long shot. The only one that maybe competed was the old Dreadnoughtus, but they've given us a new Dreadnoughtus, and that makes it better. It's really, really, really ugly. It's squat, it's misshapen and lumpen. I don't like it. And I can't in good conscience put this in C tier where we have Diplodocus, because while Diplodocus is not exciting in any way, it's just kind of boring and bland, whereas this is just really, really, really wonky in a lot of ways. I'm giving this a D.
I was going to ask where we have Diplodocus, because, like, my heart says C, but as we've previously established, I think I might have a bit of Stockholm Syndrome with this guy, because this is the animal in the game that I want to love the most, because I love Camarasaurus. It's an awesome, awesome dinosaur. It's death by a thousand cuts with this design. It's just like shoulder girdles kind of floating off the body. Bit too thin of a neck. Can't close its mouth. Nostrils kind of in the wrong place. Like, kind of more of a shrink wrap skull than I generally tend to like on a sauropod. Feet screwed up. Like, it's just every single one of them. Everyone needs like a vine boom sound or something like that to go with it. And it's just, it's D, even though it hurts me.
That was very long-winded, but I appreciate your explanation. I leave you with a brief sentiment. I make these, but only so I can look at them from a distance to have the idea of a Camarasaurus in my parks when I make a Morrison enclosure. And that, if that, 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 that sings of D for dinosaur.
Now, the whole time we've been making this video, I've been thinking that every detail about this makes me want to put it in D for detail, D for details are wrong. But yeah, the feet, like, starting from the feet, and then you get the shoulders, the head. The one thing about it is that the color, like, that it does encapsulate it at a distance. I know what's going on. And the color patterning being so nice, like, really nice. I like it a lot. I wanted to use those as leverage to put it into C. But I agree that it's not as good as Diplodocus. The only way I would put this into C is if we agreed to move Diplodocus to B. But I don't think we want to self-adjudicate. We were right the first time with Diplodocus, and we're right this time with Camarasaurus being a D.
Now Archaeonithymimus is some company.
Okay. All right, guys. So we've officially voted, and Camarasaurus becomes the second addition to D tier.
Womp womp.
And with that, it's time to spin the wheel. Are you guys ready?
Spin that wheel!
Spin
the wheel. All right. Give us something good, please.
We need to pick me up. Oh, we're getting
one. Oh, right. Yeah.
That's fun.
We have a really good one. Ooh, fun.
All right. Well, we'll actually have a really good video for you about that one, because Herrerasaurus is scientifically important and a really cool dinosaur model. So, before you go, remember to like the video, comment on the video, and subscribe to our channel, and hit the little bell so that at the exact same time every week, you'll get a notification on your phone or laptop computer that tells you that we've uploaded a video, because we will have uploaded a video about Herrerasaurus, and we don't want you to miss it. Thank you guys for watching, as always. It means a lot to us that you support the channel the way you do. Thank you so much. Have a good night, or day, or evening, or morning, whenever you watch this video. We're very tired, and we're going to go to sleep now. Thanks.
Bye. Bye.
Hi, everybody. Welcome back to...
Welcome back to Jurassic Paleontologists.
Alex, stop it.
I have such sights to show you, James.
Stop it. Get some help.
Angels to some, devils to others.